I'm a fourth and fifth grade teacher at State Street School in Windsor, Vermont. And I'm here with this gentleman.
Thank you. I'm Saul Levinson, and I visited Pat's class and spoke about Orozco and Mexican art in general, which is the program that you will be seeing. And this is sort of an introduction. And I think I'd like to hear from Pat how she found out who I was and why she invited me.
Okay. Well, I learned about Mr. Levinson through my friend Frank Lather, who's filming
my
this.
My producer!
Right, your producer, who's filming this at the moment.
Sally.
Oh, and my friend, his wife Sally. And he spoke of Saul and Helen, his wife, frequently, and said how much he enjoyed being with them. And also, did I realize what a fine painter Mr. Levinson was? And I said, no, I didn't. I wasn't aware of that. And so he showed me some of his works. And from there, it progressed to, gosh, would he come into my classroom and share his knowledge, expertise? And it just so happens that we're studying ancient Mexican cultures, and we don't know anything about murals, but we'd like to do some murals in this, in the style of the ancient Mexican cultures. So that's where it came from. And I should be looking at you, not Frank, right?
That's all right. Well, this
I'm
is
not only, used to
yeah,
this.
This is only an introduction. I'm glad to know how this thing connected, because Frank spoke to me about it. I'm always anxious, always glad, because I've been interested in education for 60 years, and having had children of my own, and wet nursing them through schools, some with trouble, and, well, they all gave me some trouble, actually. So, I'm not a stranger to children. And when we were in Mexico on my Fulbright, I was invited to do a talk like this to a group of Mexican children from first grade through six. Fascinating time. It was just a wonderful time. That's why I jumped at this opportunity. And very often I hear that from people who come to the hospital, patients who watch me paint on the murals for the cancer center, I hear this phrase, I would like to bring my family in here to expose them to your paintings. And that set me to thinking. I don't like to use the word expose, because it's like catching pneumonia. You come in and you stand and watch me paint, and then you'll become an artist, or you'll be imbued with wonderful feelings about art. And you'll notice in this film that I do my best not to expose those kids, and I want them to participate. Mm-hmm. I thought they did very well.
I did also.
Yes. In Mexico, I didn't have participation. They put on a big show for us. They had a whole assembly, all sixth grades, and I had thought that I would be do some talking and demonstrating the way I did for you.
Right.
So I was frustrated that time. When it was all over, they paid us great homage. I said to the fellow who invited us, next time you invite me, I'm going to draw. Well, we did get another invitation, and they all sixth grades, right there in the courtyard, paper and pencil and charcoal all set up, and I had a good time. That time I had a good time dealing with those kids. And I haven't had anything like that, in over a year until I entered your class. And I start with this base. All children draw, up to a point. And I wondered about the point at which a child stops drawing. Most parents will look at these indecipherable drawings and say, oh, that's wonderful, what is it? And the kid says, it's you, Daddy, or you, Mommy. And, oh, yes, yes, that's me. And then that child will stop. The child that stops is the one, generally, who's able to get attention without drawing. Mm. The one who doesn't stop is the one who needs attention and finds that he or she gets the attention if he or she continues to draw. Hmm. And I've watched this, it'll go right through the grade schools, and at a certain grade, it'll stop because something else comes in to that child's life or that student's life that compensates a lot more than drawing. And I look for those kids in your class, and there are children who are dedicated to drawing. That's because they feel something other than the compensation, and those are the kids who have the ability.
Hmm.
So I would like to visit again, just as a follow-up to see what happens.
Well, we'd like to have you.
Yeah, what has happened. Now, and I'm often asked to explain Roscoe, and that's because Roscoe belongs here. The work he did here at Dartmouth is a watershed for him. When he left here and went back to Mexico, I hear in Mexico that the work he did on his return was the greatest of all.
Wow.
So the chance to work here on such a large scale at Dartmouth was not only good for the college, but good for him. But it's so far into our culture and so foreign to our history and background that it's the stuff is very difficult for people to get. I remember it since the Depression, when we were practically on the same plane. We were becoming as deprived as the Mexicans. Many of us were down at their level. So those things had meaning. But that was the problem of how to present this to the children. A thing that has very little meaning now for most adults. Once in a while when I've been going through the corridor where they are, I meet people who have come from far away just to see them. And those people who appreciate them are those who are historians.
And I do have in my class, and I won't use the word historians,
yeah,
but I have some children who truly do right now enjoy history.
Oh, sure.
And so I think that for some of them, it was interesting. Also, some of the children enjoy the myths that we read about from the ancient Mexican cultures. And it was interesting for them to see, I won't pronounce it, Quetzalcoatl.
Yeah.
It was interesting for them to see him in the human form. They didn't envision him that way.
Ah. Now, another thing that interests me to find out as a follow-up is their ability to relate all this to Greek and Roman myths or Near Eastern myths. And I'm not up to date as what's being taught in high school. When I ended high school, a required course was ancient history. And
mm-hmm.
We got mythology. We had unabridged literature, not little short sessions. So it'd be interesting. I don't know what is being taught now at the high school level, freshman year. Is there such a thing as ancient history being taught?
That's a good question. I'm sorry, I can't answer that.
Well, when you get back to class, I would like to find out one thing. I think one good clue is how many children bedeviled their parents about family history.
After seeing the murals, or just
at any
do
time,
they ask?
At any time. I know in my family, we kept asking our parents about their history, their parents, their grandparents. Of course, they were from Europe, so, and we had no contact. I never knew a grandparent. I had a step-grandmother, but I never knew a real grandfather or grandmother on either side of the family, neither did my sisters, and so we were very much interested in the history of the family and the history of the area in which they lived. We want to know all about it. I wonder if there are any children who do that today.
That is a good question. It's a very good question, particularly because our family is being redefined in our society today.
That is.
And I remember the first time I asked my students, go home and talk to your parents about your grandparents and your family. And I discovered one little girl didn't know who her father was.
Uh-huh.
And furthermore, her mother didn't want to discuss who her father was. And so it's different.
Yeah, it is.
Now.
It certainly. But on the other hand, the days when there was great immigration, I have a friend with whom I taught, whose father came ahead of the family. He was one of the Italian stoneworkers from Carrara,
mm-hmm.
marble workers from Carrara, who ended in Bari.
Yeah.
And my friend was 5 or 6 years old before he met his father.
Yeah.
And in Mexico, I met another Italian who's been living in Mexico for 60 years, more than 60 years, who had to wait 7 years in a mountainous village of 4 houses before his father could send for him
yeah.
and his mother. And he'd never seen his father. So this goes back, this was not unusual, that the men came over.
Mm-hmm.
Back then, the late 1800s, mid-1800s, up until World War I, came over to pave the way, and some of them never sent for their wives. It's created problems for those kids.
Right.
So this family problem is not something...
It's not new.
It may be new to native borns and descendants of native borns, but was not new to foreigners at all.
Right.
But I would like to come back, talk with those kids. In the meantime, I would like to hear from them, when I come back, what they know about their own family histories. Started on ancient history, my ancient history during the Depression and before, we'll never get to the film. But I want you to know what kind of preparation I had from my earliest years for coming into your class. And I hope when we see the film that we'll get the reaction, that I'll see the reaction that I remember, or I think I remember, and enjoy seeing that again.
I think you will.
Thank you for inviting me, Pat.
Thank you, and we'll look forward to seeing you.